Welcome to my session and thank you for attending. My name is André Bergner. I'm from Berlin, Germany. I'm working for Native Instruments. We are an audio software company, so we do music software for people who want to create music with computers. And of course, if you do music, there's signal processing involved. I mean, even though that I'm working for the company, that was always a hobby of mine, so I was doing that a lot also in the past, and also I'm a physicist, so I was doing data analysis, so I was always kind of dealing with signal processing from different perspectives, and also writing a lot of software, so I thought I had many attempts to writing signal processing software, and finally hope I can have a better library now for that, so at least a more flexible one. So there are a few hints in this title. First of all, there is this towards an EDSL. So towards means it's not finished. So it's just I'm just on the route to something, and I'm working on that alone currently. And I just wanted to present it. So it's kind of an intermediate state, but it's working. And I'm basically presenting my current results, which I have. And then there's a second hint for those of you who are familiar with DSP, maybe a few hands if you know about signal processing. Okay, half of the audience, kind of. So then you might know the Z minus one. So this is a hint to this inherent delay in signal processing. So if you do signal processing, this is like your central thing, and it's part of the library name, kind of. So Flow Z or Flows or whatever you want to call it is the library name. So. Okay, little overview. This should work now, hopefully. So I will start introducing a little bit to signal processing, just a few slides and about what is it, and to get you on the right track. Then in the title there's EDSL, so that means domain-specific language or embedded. So I will quickly talk about EDSLs and what kind of domain-specific languages they are already existing for that kind of topic. And then in the last three parts, I come to my actual library, explain how it works and how you use it, and a little bit about the backend, which is more the C++ part of things. Okay, signal processing. So what is signal processing? So I left the digital away there. So because if you do analog signal processing, you design stuff that looks like that. So you design some circuits, write it down, and then you do some math, some differential equations potentially, and do some rules and derive some currents, and then you implement stuff that looks like this. So that's like a first attempt. So you start iterating. And over the years, you improve, and it looks like this. And then you get really professional, and you have a really nice modular framework for doing analog signal processing. So this is kind of the goal where we want to go. How does it look in the digital domain? So sorry for the kind of ugly slides. I just looked for stuff in the internet, so I didn't want to create it all on my own. So this would be a typical digital signal processing diagram or flow graph. So now you have your delays here, for instance. That means there's some data flowing through that graph and it gets multiplied or added. There's some output here. That's a really simple example of one of those circuits, digital circuits. But there's always this kind of flow of samples or data through that kind of network. Here's another example. So here are some down and up samplers, just another one how it could look like. Then you might write down some Z-plane Fourier transform expressions and analyze your circuit. You do some math. Then you end up with some difference equation. So that's something where you have an update rule. So you have your, basically this is already your C array or C++ array, which you have indices into some data past. So it's indexing into the past of your data. And then you have some coefficients that get multiplied and you add that up. Also just a random equation I found. And then you implement that, and then you have code that looks somehow like this. So usually DSP code has a lot of Hungarian notation for some weird reason. But yeah, that's just one typical example of DSP code. So maybe also a few words about applications. So applications, I mean, I put that our domain as the first spot, audio sound effects, so that's a typical application I'm working in, so which is our domain where we definitely need signal processing. Then another big one is image video processing, so this whole, so probably also Lena maybe, and all those image processing done on those pictures. So this is a sound example, but then you have all kind of like medical imaging, data analysis, and if you do data analysis, then there's also like this, I mean, seismology, forecasting in general, business forecasting, all kinds of forecasting, weather forecasting, everywhere you have kind of signal processing involved in some way. I mean, I'm focusing more on those circuits, so if you look at it in a broader sense, then you also have more abstract algorithms and statistics coming into that topic, but so I'm more focusing, I'm coming from that perspective, and maybe that library also works for other stuff, maybe for some better, for some less good, so that depends. Just a few applications mentioned. Oops, sorry, it was too fast. This is a typical, just to get you on what I'm talking about, those are typical standards. So if you take a DSP textbook and you will read about those so-called direct forms, so this is just my example. I'm working on a lot because you can study the library implementation and that kind of stuff. So those are typical circuits. So what you see here is, so you have to read it, your input comes from here, that's your output, so you have this kind of flow, so it's a directed graph, and I mean it's pretty obvious to read, I think. So here if you addition, those triangles are multiplications, and I already mentioned this box with the z to power minus 1 is a delay. So this is memory, kind of state. Here you have an addition and multiplication. So that's basically what this thing describes. Here the same thing. And those two things actually, if you run input through it, they actually produce the same output, but there are certain symmetry rules on those graphs. So if you swap those graphs, so you can kind of split it here and have five pluses instead of three or even one, depends on how you draw that thing, and then you can swap it because it's a linear system, you can swap swap it around, and then you end up with a system where the delay suddenly is in the center, and then you suddenly see from the structure that you can actually reuse the delay and have only two delay states and instead of four in that case, but they produce the same output, but they have internally different structure. And if you write down that in a C++ code, so this is just a really simple example. So that would be the code for this structure, and that would be the handcrafted code for that structure. So they are called direct form and one and two, respectively. And then here you see already, here I have four states, x1, x2, y1, and y2, and my five coefficients, and here I have only two internal states. And then if you write it down, you see that the implementation looks very different. So here you actually compute first the whole thing, and then you do your state update in that step. And here it's kind of intermingled, so state and computation is like intermingled. Actually, it turns out that this implementation, even though you might think this is faster because it has less memory and memory transfer, it's even slower if you benchmark it because it, sorry.
Should there be like a flip before y0 and direct form 2?
A flip?
Float.
A float.
Yeah, declaration.
Ah, yeah, sorry. Yeah, there's a float missing, that's correct. Yeah, that kind of got. Yeah. got swallowed. Yeah, exactly. There's a float missing. I think the point is that you can, the processor, due to the CPU instruction pipelining, can intermingle those memory transfer and operations better than in that case. So, but that's just a detail. Anyway, so the. The left one is. So at least from the benchmarks I did, the direct form one is faster. Yeah.
Depends on your computer.
Probably as well. Yeah. I guess so. At least on MacBooks. but that's not the topic of the talk. So the point is, you actually, if you do DSP, you think you think about math and equations, but you also have stuff like that. So the DSP guys in our company. Or at least there's one that thinks only in those graphs, and it would be nice to actually have a language which lets you more describe the graph structure instead of a kind of translating that into a class where you have to declare state and then now you swap it and suddenly you have to kind of refactor your whole class. You have this issue of which is, so you don't have the structure directly represented in code here. It's kind of, you have to really refactor your code if you do a little change. Yes?
So what's the advantage of direct form 2 then?
They behave differently under modulation, and they are different. They have different under noise. They behave differently, so it depends on rounding issues. There's a lot of whole books about that, I guess.
So it provides an improved result mathematically, although it's slower.
Mathematically, if you start modulating the coefficients, mathematically you will have a different result, just really abstract, just from the math. But if you now go into a DSP, so if you implement it in a machine, you have always kind of finite precision, and you have rounding noise, and then the rounding noise will be different. So some will be more stable on low frequencies, for instance, stuff like that. This is just two. There are actually two other ones, and the fourth one is actually the best under for low frequency, I think, and also under modulation. Okay, this is just motivation so far. So the idea is, how can I work more closer to, I hope it didn't crash now or something like that. No. I have to be faster. That's what it's telling me. So let's design a domain-specific language, or first look what has happened so far. So first little introduction, what is a domain-specific language? So a domain-specific language is a language specialized to a particular application domain. So you all know HTML, CSS, SQL. Those are domain-specific languages. And an embedded domain-specific language is it's a DSL that is written in a usually generic language like C++ or JavaScript or something like that. And therefore it's embedded in that other language. So Boost Spirit would be a famous example for the C++ community. I just made up an example because I was working with that recently in some project. In JavaScript, for like database communication, you have a lot of stuff like that, where you have like database select, blah, something from where starts with, or some, this is kind of an embedded domain-specific language for communication with database servers. In JavaScript, you see that a lot. Huh?
They
booked
that in 1992.
Why? You mean?
That thing, yeah.
Ah, okay, yeah.
That was a good idea.
Okay, anyway, so this is just mentioning domain-specific languages. Then the topic was, coming back quickly to those graphs. Oh, that was super fast. So I want to have a language for that, and it happened that there's already a mathematical language for that. It's called the algebra of Lonomials. There are some books about that. It's written by, or kind of derived by some guy, George Stefanescu. So don't look at the slide in too much detail. But what the point is here, you have those structures like, it's a language where you can describe a directed graph with it, but with certain constraints. So you have those arrows, for instance, and crossings and joins and splits and arrows that start, and you describe, so you have kind of a mathematical language in symbols where you can describe a graph, and you can kind of analyze the structure of the graph and analyze the symmetries and things like that, instead of coming with graph theory where you have just a set of vertices and nodes, which is much more generic, but also due to the constraints has a broader use case. But in this kind of use case, which we have in signal processing, we have usually a flow, sorry, directed graph, but with certain constraints and certain typical structures. So this stuff exists, and here's just one example. So I forgot the slide with all the operators, but I know there is actually another one. So for instance, you have this kind of operator, this arrow operator, which means feedback through around a box. And then he talks a lot about, now I have two boxes and the feedback goes around all of three, but there's no other wire, and then there are certain identities, and you have some theorems that prove stuff and so on. So you have, we have already a nice mathematical foundation for that kind of stuff. So I don't want to mention, don't want to talk too much about that. There is already kind of an implementation. That's a language called FAUST. So that stands for functional audio streams. So guys already thought about that, and they discovered that work and kind of derived this kind of language. So this comes from the audio community. It's like audio streams. So it was, the idea of this library was and like a lot of modern music, especially if you do like electronic music like we are doing or those guys are probably doing, you have the problem of that music nowadays is more, or a lot of stuff happens in sound design, like in particular in those DSP algorithms. So you have like the algorithm is pretty important for how your music sounds and not so much like the notes. Like 200 years ago, they wrote down the notes and you can kind of still reconstruct that piece of music. But now today, if you would create some electronic piece of music with your DSP or with your synthesizers that have certain DSP algorithms, and then you want to recreate that in 50 years from now, you can just take the recording, that's all you have, but it's pretty much impossible. So there's no way to reconstruct the DSP. Maybe you can still run that software, but probably very unlikely. So they thought, let's have a language that kind of abstracts that, and we can write musical algorithms in an abstract way so that we can reconstruct that later. So they came up with that idea. So this is a domain-specific language focusing on reproducible audio DSP. It's pure functional and declarative, so there's a lot of Haskell inspiration in that language. But it needs a separate compiler that compiles either to C++, and lately there's also a ALLVM bytecode backend for that. So, I mean, it's working, but it's yet another language, and it's you have to compile it separately, and if you want to use it, you have to do some stuff, and also benchmarks show that it's not ideal the way it's working right now. And I mean, we have some people that were looking into that. They say also not so. I mean, it's a really interesting approach, but there are some disadvantages, obviously. So, yes, and some examples just to give you an idea how that looks like. So, if you're familiar with Haskell, you kind of see the similarities there. So, for instance, an add operation in Faust would be you just write plus, and that's your function, which is a binary function, which takes two arguments and adds them together. Or you can make it more explicit using those deep regime indices with underscore plus underscore, then you have, which is the same as the first line. Or then you can define your crossing of two wires, which is that kind of thing, pretty ugly, or that's not ugly, but pretty intense or pretty short. So that's also some what people kind of dislike a little bit, but I mean, if you're a fan of functional programming, you might get used to the compact stuff. Then differentiator would be something like that. What that means is you have one input, you split it into two. One is identity, one is goes through memory, and followed by that, there is a subtraction of both. So that's how you have to read that line. Or you can have an integrator, which is a binary operation going through a feedback, with feedback going through the identity function. So I explained that a little bit more, but from the perspective of my library, which works a little bit different than that, but it's inspired by this. Or the classical one-pole filter would be something like that. It's basically similar to that, but here's a multiplication in that path. And here you have the kind of the expression, sorry, it's a little bit dark, but kind of written into kind of an array form. So your output y is your export x minus the previous export and things like that. So that's how this language kind of works, and then you can build more complex structures from that. So here's just one slide, so you see what kind of operators exist. So this was from the algebra of Flournoys, from this mathematical stuff, and this is Faust, or kind of a mathematical version of Faust, I think. So there's those annotations, so you have those feedback, you have sequence, you can combine stuff in parallel, you have some identity, you need that. Here's transposition, or kind of crossing of wires, then splitting and joining of wires. Yes?
What's the AOF stand for the type of operation on the left-hand side, and the BDA is the syntax, the way you notate it? Is that?
The question is what those stand for. So AOF is algebra of Flournoys. Okay. This is the mathematical theory I showed you before. So I think that actually should be here. I think I'm not quite sure. And BDA, actually, I don't know. I just copied that from the paper. I don't remember what that means. Okay, but that's just, yet you see there is already something existing. There are those operators, and then kind of describe your structure of your graph. Okay, so I thought, I mean, I already thought a lot about those. It would be nice to have a domain-specific language for DSP, and I was more thinking of about at least getting rid of the state. So writing those classes, you have a lot of clutter. You have to define a class. You have, or I mean, nowadays you could maybe use lambdas or generic lambdas, which makes sense. Some, but that's also only usable for like small things. And you always have to write, if you want to have bigger structures, you have to get some types and then combine them. And it's cumbersome. And especially as I showed you in the initial example, dealing with the state is kind of tricky. So depending on how you structure your stuff, suddenly the state might change. You have to give it a name, even though you don't care about the name and all this kind of stuff. You have a lot of overhead. So it would be nice to have a language that helps us doing stuff like this. And then inspired by that, I also looked, how would I do that in C++? And I sat down and started with it. And now I come to my main part, which is where I explain the of my flows library, the syntax and the semantics, so the building blocks of how I put that stuff together. So let's start with some really simple building blocks. So you have always to think in those little boxes, like those little black boxes, basically, that do some sort of processing. They can have arbitrary, there's just few examples, they can have arbitrary number of inputs and outputs, so something like one input, one output, or two inputs and one output, or one input and two outputs, or anyway, n inputs and m outputs. But in a kind of explicit form, like if you would have like a big graph library where you have like a node and then you have virtual functions like number of inputs and number of outputs, and then you have to overload them and define them. So usually you do a lot of overhead like that. Here it's all implicitly, so they kind of emerge the number of inputs and output depending on how your structure look like. So you never have to specify them. You just have to know that they're whatever you write down, there is always this kind of, it describes this kind of box that has a number of inputs and outputs. So that's the way you have to read it or kind of think about it on the semantic level. So then I thought, good starting point. I mean, I could recreate like the Faust stuff, or I thought maybe it's better to start with something existing in C++. And I basically took Boost Lambda. So who's familiar with Boost Lambda? The old Boost Lambda, so pretty much everybody. So I won't explain it in all detail, just recap. You have those placeholders, so you know that also from the standards. Since C++ 11, we have them in the standard as well. But they originated in Boost, and Boost Lambda was previous, so in C++ 98, sorry?
Yeah, were you able to reuse the underscore one from Boost Lambda?
No, I defined my own one because I needed some special internal stuff. Yeah. Okay. Maybe I could reuse it, but I mean, this is it's one line of code to define those. So what it does, for instance, if you use Boost Lambda, so as the name already said, it creates Lambda. So underscore one plus underscore two creates a little Lambda function, which is a binary function, which adds its input, which has two input arguments. And basically, the biggest underscore n defines the number of inputs you have in your expression. Yes, first there, question. I come to that in a moment. So the question was, how do I distinguish between input and output? And I will explain it in a moment.
Okay, so if I understand, so the idea being is, for example, the add and scale, that's sort of an expression. And that expression creates something similar to a Boost Lambda that is in your language. So if I wrote that expression, that would be sort of, that expression represents that box.
Exactly. So the question is, what does that represent? If I write down that, it represents a little box which has two input wires, you could say. This little box is a little processor that takes the inputs and kind of adds, scales the second one with some number and adds it to the first one and produces one output. So you have those boxes. And I mean, you can use, that's basically a low level. So the fundamental building blocks are basically similar. If you're used to Boost Lambda, you basically use it pretty much the same, except that I have some operators which I need for my library, so which are kind of esoteric anyways. And yeah, that's basically where I started. And so I thought, yeah, let's reuse it. I mean, it has some advantages. I have basically named, I can name those inputs. So in like this Faust language, you have just the underscore, and then you have to think the Haskell kind of way. So if, for instance, underscore plus underscore is like actually two inputs, but maybe you want to have more control and reuse one of those indices. So that's really nice in that kind of Boost Lambda style. I'll come to that in a moment. Yeah. So anyways, it's basically the idea was starting at Boost Lambda. And so I recreated that and then built on top of this. So what comes next? So now you have the fundamental boxes, and now you want to combine those. So what I have four fundamental combinators. So how to combine those boxes? There are two obvious ones. That is like sequence and parallel. So sorry, that's a little bit hard to see probably. So sequence is just a basically function composition. So if you have one box that produces one output, and then you have followed by another box that has one takes one input, it's basically the same as function composition. So just read it as function composition with a few examples. I explain that in a moment. So what happens if you have more inputs than outputs and things like that? There's a little bit different behavior there. Parallel is just taking two boxes and putting them in parallel and basically creating a new bigger box that has n. So if you have n inputs in the first box and m inputs in the second, then you have n plus m inputs in the overall box, and the same for the outputs. Multi-channel, I show some examples in a moment, so that's maybe more getting more clear. Multi-channel is, so the difference here is _1 and _1 would be both two fundamental boxes, identity boxes that just go through. And I combine them, and that creates a box with two inputs. With a comma, I can create a box or a combination which has only one input. So this is the same _, it's the same, so it directs to the same input, but the way you have to read it is I create a tuple of outputs all coming from the same input. So basically it's a box that takes all the inputs and then creates several output wires, kind of. Yes?
So, with the box, when you say the sequence box, and with I'm assuming doing some magic overloading of the assignment operators and those sort of things, or the OR operator. But is it the case that box here would represent that sort of expression from the previous slide?
Exactly.
So on the feedback one, for instance, it would be like tilde open paren _1 plus _2. Close paren would represent a adder box that has a feedback.
Exactly. So the question is, what are those boxes? So the boxes can be any kind. So it can be the boxes from the previous, so fundamental boxes, so which are really fundamental operations, but they can be combined. So I mean, a combination of two boxes is again a bigger box that can be reused. So you can of course combine them into, you can build arbitrary big expressions from it. Yes, the question?
How would you handle the input channel?
The input channel?
It's decided at runtime. Like, in audio units, like on Apple, it'll tell you, it doesn't tell you the channels until you actually instantiate the units plug in, and then you decide.
I mean, this is more a runtime. So the question is, how would I distinguish or know the number of input channels? Is that correct? I mean, this is really compile time. So I want to build an little DSP algorithm where I know at compile time it's stereo, it has two inputs or something like that. So
with the channel formats for audio units, you have to tell it, I've changed the format, which is a property change which causes the whatever the algorithm underneath the hood to reconstitute itself. It sort of doesn't, so in this one it'd be like, hey, I'm changing maybe some dynamic type, and you instantiate, okay, this block of code now is what represents two channels, and this block would be my
Yeah, exactly. So I would have two different instances or two different compiled instances. And then I would choose them at runtime, which also is much more efficient. I think that would be pretty inefficient if I would have built that in the structure. Yes?
Yeah. Another one, Andre, is for the feedback, is it implied that you always do a feedback to channel one? You don't get the choice?
I come to the feedback, Okay, feedback I haven't mentioned yet. So feedback is that's the most interesting one, because that's the most tricky one. I mean, if you think about it for a moment, you already see the problem. Feedback, that means you have your output, or your input depends on your own output, I mean, which is always a problem. So you have kind of this implicit dependency, and you need to have some form, either the language would somehow reformulate that and make it this kind of implicit formulation, make it explicit, kind of solve your equation for that output, or you have to have a delay. And here the solution is, right now at least, you need to have some form of delay, and I come to delay in a next step. So that's why feedback is a little bit more tricky. And now the interesting part is the delay. So I mean, there's a Z in the library name, so I mean the delay is pretty fundamental, or the state. First I want to quickly mention the operators before I come. So maybe you are wondering why I choose that one and that one. This is simply because in C++ you're kind of bound to the operator precedence and this kind of stuff, and I had to choose something which is kind of doesn't look totally weird if you use it, and which has this kind of intuitive precedence if you look at the structure, so you don't have to write too many parentheses all the time. So that's the only. And here I'm using actually the same operator as in Faust in this other language, tilde. So, but it just happened that it is a nice fit for this kind of logic. So delay. So how does delay work? Now you have a sequence of two boxes in that case, for instance. I'm just working on identity boxes now. So I have an identity followed by an identity, but this identity has a delay. So the idea was, okay, I have already the input arguments. Wouldn't it be nice if I could just index into my input? So if I basically have a function, x and y basically, as input, if you would give it a name, or underscore one and underscore two, and now I want to have like the previous value of my input, and I, instead of having some delay and I have to explicitly create it, I just want to say what I mean. I want your previous output or your previous input and or the previous output of the previous box, and or the second to before that or whatever. So any kind of number. So you could write it like this. So you could just say brackets and minus one. The problem with that is this: the minus one is not known at compile time. But I want to have it statically known at compile time, so I can create state. I mean, I could do that as well. That's also interesting. So I thought about that. But for if you for instance have a really long delay line and you want to modulate that and things like that, but then of course you always have the overhead of creating memory on the heap and so on. I start here and then next question.
So the idea being is, you would have an object that would overload the bracket operator, and then if it's overloading the bracket operator, it's taking in an input, and that input would be implied an integer in that case because you declared it that way, which means you'd have to determine at runtime. Is that what you're saying? That's why you found yourself having to supply it a type, not a literal.
Yeah, exactly. So the question is why I had to do that choice. I need to know a type that defines the input delay, not a precise integer, because integer just is not known at compile time. I just know that it's an integer. Okay, now you.
Could you have used angle brackets instead of square brackets to solve that problem?
Kind of. But then you would have to create an instance, so it would be like a template. So the question is, if I could have used angled brackets, then I would need to create an instance of, then underscore one would be more a type. Then the type has a parameter which I can put in the brackets integer, and then but then I have to create an instance, so I have to also put curly braces afterwards. So it would be pretty awkward to use. Yeah, would be possible, but I mean, one workaround is if you use Boost HANA, you can use those. I mean, they have this compile time constants, but it's a little bit long, and I just thought, just reuse underscore one. C++ developers are used to kind of having the same symbol in different contexts with totally different meaning, and that's the shortest way. It's like just dropping the minus, and then you end up with this.
In one context, the underscore one is an actual, it's a variable, it's an instance, and in the other one, it's a type.
No, it's in this kind of, this in underscore one is an index into your input, your number of, the index of your input parameter, and the other one is an index into the past of that parameter. So both mean an index of some sort of array or abstract array. Yeah, question there.
Does it actually take an arrow constant like you showed there, or is it underscore c? Because the underscore c creates an arrow constant. Does it accept it? Like, so say that you want to do like minus 100. Do you have placeholders up to 100?
No, so far, I mean, the idea for those compile time placeholders would be rather of short delays, so like 1, 2, 3, maybe 5. If you really want to have big delays, so really long input delays, then you would rather go this way, and then but then you have to extend the library, so which is not supported yet, and you have to create memory on the heap, and you could use that. I mean, that should work as well. Yes.
Sample, or?
Yeah, so the question is, what's the unit? And the unit is sample, so it's all sample based. I mean, this is which is typical for sample. I mean, on the fundamental level, you're on a sample level. More questions on the delay? So I think that's a little bit maybe weird in the first time. Okay, the idea is you have brackets to index into the path of an input parameter. So now that is pretty important for the feedback, because as I mentioned already, feedback requires some sort of, it has this implicit declaration of output of input depending or the output depending on the input. So you have to have some sort of delay, and that's basically how you would use the feedback in a real scenario. So this would be a typical integrator. So you basically integrate your input, and you just have to index the first. So the feedback now coming, I think it was your question. Do you have control over the how the feedback works? So the way it works, it takes the output channel and wires them around, starting from the first one. So in that case, I have one output and I wired around and connected to the first input. If I would have two, it would wire around and would connect to both. If I would have three, it would wire around two of them and the third one would be kind of hanging down there. Or if I, so I have no control, I cannot just put it in the second one, but I come to that also later how you would solve that. You can just build structures that handle that problem. So it always goes from the starting from the beginning, so the connection, and it takes all. It feeds really feeds all the output through the input again. So you don't have control of, I just want to take the first one. Okay, so that's the feedback. Okay, now there are some examples. So just how, what you would, if you would run that program, I mean, I come to that, how that actually works a little bit later, but first off, just the expression with some input and output. So identity is pretty obvious. You feed some stuff in, you get the same stuff out. Adding would be a binary function. So you have two inputs and they get added and produce that output. So they have one output channel. At scales, basically pretty similar. A sequence of two identity functions would be, again, an identity function. So mathematically, that's the same. Parallel, so I have basically now I have two channels. So one is just identity, the other one is two times identity. Now I have to feed two channels in and I get two channels out. So you see, and the second one gets multiplied by two. And the first one is identity. Same expression, but now with comma. So now you see the difference. So this expects two inputs, this only expects one input because they index to the same argument. But basically the output is kind of a tuple of two values, so it creates two values. And it's the first one is just the input, and the second one is two times the input. And then delay, it just delays the input. So if you feed in like 3 to 1, you get 0, 3 to 1. And the starting value is always 0. So I mean, right now it's just initialized with the default value of the inner structure or of that type. And for feedback, so this would be an integrator. That means it integrates, it just sums all the input up. And so if you would feed a 1 followed by 0, you just get 1 as output because it was adding the 1 and then it adds 0, 0, 0, so it doesn't change. Yes?
I've noticed integer math. Is that intentional or?
The question is integer math. This is just to make it simpler and save some dots and zeros there. So just for the slide. So currently, actually, I mean, but maybe a good point. Right now, it's all hard-coded to float, but it would in theory be no problem to extend it to automatically derive the type of the wire so that you could even have like complex numbers suddenly, and then you have kind of a wire that has complex types on, and then followed by something that just takes a real number of it, and then you have a real wire or converted to integer or whatever. So that would be an extension, but I was focusing more on the structure so far. So the wires are currently hard-coded to float. But that's not a limitation. A few more examples. So with delay and feedback. So a differentiator, so that's something that takes a difference, a consecutive difference of values would be, here's some input and output, would look like that. That would be a so-called leaky integrator. That is also an integrator, but in the feedback path, so the one that wires around, it gets always halved. And so you get an output that looks like that, so decaying. So for that input, and that's the same. Now, if I would change the step size, or if I wouldn't index the previous one, but the previous to that one, so index minus 2, then I would have zeros interleaved into output. Because actually the second one, that would be like a zero input, and that produces again zero output. So I mean, if I would feed in 1, 1, for instance, you would have just always the same sequence, 1, 1, dot 5, dot 5, and so on. So it kind of is an interleaved filter that works on every second. So for instance, this kind of stuff you could use if you have stereo input of sound and you have it like interleaved, so always left, right, left, right. You could go to that form, and then you have a kind of a stereo filter on the same structure, on the same data. Okay, that's Now, some more complex structures. So if you have a little bit more of those boxes, or as I mentioned already, what if the number of inputs and outputs don't fit? Those are the scenarios that are possible, or some of them exactly. So imagine you have a box with one input and one output, followed by a box which takes actually two inputs. The resulting box will be seen as a box that has two inputs, where the first one, so the first input goes through the first box, and the second input kind of bypasses and goes into the second box. So that's the logic of the combiners and how they are seen basically as the resulting box. Same for the other way around. So if the first box has two outputs and the second box only has one input, then you kind of have to see it as a wire hanging here, and then you can connect it to whatever comes afterwards. And if you combine both together, you see what kind of structure results. So if one box with two outputs and one with two inputs, but in between there's a box which has only one input and one output, it will just be put into the first channel and the second will just go through. And if you combine that with delay, then it looks like this. Now, basically same example, but now with delay. Here in the box in the center is kind of a unit delay box that takes the input and delays it. And the second box is also a box which delays it second, just random example. And that's kind of the structure that would be created under the hood. So that's what it means.
So
yes?
So it's implied that the structure, the topology, follows the left to right rule. Like it's sort of the boxes are going, from your left to the right in the same way that your syntax and your assignments are going left to right. So
yeah, so the question is, the rules imply the sequence from left to right. Yes, exactly. So left, I mean, it's kind of input always starts left and then it feeds into the next. So it's kind of, I also thought about using the arrow equal operator to make that more verbose, that it kind of, that you see kind of that goes into that direction, similar to those IO streams. So, but I thought, okay, that's a little bit too long and you have to write too much stuff. That's the only reason, but could be changed. Yeah, but the sequence always from left to right. So input starts left and then it goes to right. Just a few more examples. Okay, I skipped that, it's not so interesting. But no, that's an interesting one. So little riddle for the audience. So imagine now you have that kind of structure. So you have two existing boxes somewhere, some processors, and you have them basically running in parallel. Both take two inputs and produce one output. Could be, for instance, just a simple addition or something more complex. But now you have cross feedback. So the output from the first box goes into the input of the second, and the output of the second goes into the input of the first. So, and how would I write down that in my structure? Has anybody an idea already? So I can just
split the boxes and decompose it horizontally.
Split the boxes, those A and B boxes?
Yeah.
They are black boxes. I cannot split them. I cannot change anything.
And then you can't lay them out sequentially like you did before, because you could feed back one. You could feed one into the other, but you can't go all the way backwards. Of course, you made a giant delay, a giant feedback for the outer box.
That goes in the kind of the right direction.
Do you define a new variable representing the state there?
All the stuff I presented now can be used, and the solution is actually pretty simple once you found it. So I also got that from the paper of Faust. They had a similar problem. So you kind of, if you take those wires, I actually wanted to make do a nice animation, but if you like take them and hang them around kind of and kind of cross them a little bit, and that's why you have those crossing operators in Faust and this Flonomial, because you need them exactly for that kind of problem. So you kind of, you use the big feedback, so the one feedback that's already existing, so in the end it's one feedback. And if you feedback, so if you take two boxes, if you combine them in parallel, so that's you start with a parallel combiner, and then you put feedback around that. So that's the two outputs go into the inputs, and together they have four inputs, because each box has two inputs, so together they have four inputs and two outputs. So the two outputs go through the first two inputs of the resulting expression, and then there are two free. But now I want, if I would just leave it that way, the two feedback inputs would go both into box A, and box B would get the input from outside. But I don't want that. I want this kind of structure, so I have to do this kind of crossing. So I can now use my multi-channel comma operator and just rewire them and say the first input gets the second gets the third gets the fourth I can just drop because it implicitly goes by. If I don't, I could name it also, I could also say comma underscore four, if it would be the same. And then I basically describe this kind of structure. So that's identical to this structure, and that's how you would work with this kind of language. And if you have more complex structure, you always have to think, how can I rewrite that so it fits into the syntax? Yes?
Does that expression match the diagram?
It should, if I didn't make a mistake. Yeah, it should match the diagram. So this is a parallel combination, so they are parallel. The feedback goes, the two output feedbacks go into the two, four inputs, so you could also see a dot here, actually.
Is the first not going to the third?
The second, so you have three inputs here, so three, and the second goes into the first. So the first input gets the input from the second input gets the input from the third, and the third input gets the input from the first. It's correct. So that's, it's a little bit confusing in the beginning, but once you get used to it, actually, it's pretty nice. Okay, that's so far about the complex structure. So that's about how the language works and how you translate the syntax into graphs, essentially, and processing boxes. And now, how would you use it? How would you write a program that actually, how does a program look like implementing that? So using the library, so using flows, this is kind of the hello world example. So you include the header, you import the namespace, so you have access to the placeholders here. Let's define a simple integrator. So that would be the example from the slides. So underscore two plus the first index delayed by one and feedback around that. And now something I didn't mention so far, you have to compile that. So in order to get the state. So what this compile function does for you, it takes expression. So this expression is really just an expression so far at that point. So unlike boost lambda, where actually the expression itself can be called, but that's possible because there is no state involved. So it's pretty easy to just put a parentheses operator or call operator on the expression. So that's what I did there. And if you feed some input in, it immediately produces output. So it's kind of an expression which has some functionality. So I cannot do that easily. I thought about that, but it gets really messy as soon as you start building bigger structures, because then it's unclear where your state lives and you cannot really reuse state. That's something which I want to do. And it's not really possible. So that's why I need this kind of compile step. So what exactly this does, it just takes an expression and creates a function object for you, which you can then feed the input. And here down, I use it. So I just have a little for loop. I feed some input in it and just call this proc stands for processor, call this processor with the input. And then it will produce the output. So it will integrate those numbers. So that would be the fundamental kind of way to use it. So, I skipped that. That was some
question.
Yeah.
Why do you need that compile step? Can't you build this into the whenever you instantiate it, you just compile it or something?
No, that's a problem. I mean, if I would create the state, I mean, the compiler starts parsing that, and at that point, it would already create state for this expression, and then it would take TC the add. And see another expression that might index into the same delay, but then has a separate state. So if I have something like underscore one with input delay two plus underscore one, something like that. Where does the state live now? In that part, on that part, or how do they share it? And then I would have to. Maybe it's possible, but it would be really ugly to implement that, I think.
So you could chain this, so if you have this auto integrator,
yeah.
You could create another one and then chain them together and then compile the result of that or something like that, yes?
Now the idea of the compilation step is that it analyzes the expression as a whole and can figure out where the state actually needs or how much state I actually need, and not because if you would do that for this thing locally, the state would be somehow locally in that expression. And then if you combine that with another expression that indexes into the same state.
I think he's asking, what is the point of assigning that expression into a variable as opposed to just passing it to compile
directly?
Ah, okay.
Exactly. Sorry. Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Yeah, the name is understood you, sorry. So why I don't just put it in here?
Yeah.
Just to give it a name. That's all. So it's you can just put the expression directly in here, of course.
Yeah, but you can also
you could reuse it.
Yeah, exactly. The yeah, exactly. I mean, this
one box to combine them together.
You will see example where I reuse it, so that's why I needed to give it a name somehow. Yeah, I mean, that's the whole point of reusing it in order to build bigger expressions. I think actually it's that slide, exactly. So here I give it a name and I reuse it. So this is now taking an example from audio. So there's this called Moog lattice filter, a classical filter from, I don't know, from the 70s or maybe even older, which is like a certain low pass filter, which has self oscillation and some nice property for audio, for music DSP basically. And this kind of filter looks like you have four low pass filters. So this is your lattice. So if you implement it in an analog way, you have a lattice where you have all those cross wires, and that's why it's called a lattice filter. So you have four low pass filters and you have a big feedback around that. So you have now small building blocks that creates a bigger structure. So how would you implement that? So you start off with the first low pass filter, though I called it one pole because that's for the DSP guys, they probably know what I'm talking about. So I called it one pole. It's a simple, really simple filter. So it has feedback and just a really simple integrator with some coefficients. I need four of those, so I put them all into a chain. And then I put feedback around this whole chain with some saturation function. So I need the tench function here. I'm using Bose Proto, by the way, so I come to that next slide. So I can just make it available for my language or for my expression trees and use it here. So I can apply this tench function onto the input delayed plus a second argument and then feedback around the whole structure. So this thing describes that kind of structure. Then I compile it and I can use it. Yes, next question.
How can I adjust my parameters? It seems like you've built them into...
The parameter, that's a good question. How can I adjust my parameters? So far they are hard-coded, but I mean, there are several ways. Either maybe you want to modulate them or you just want... I mean, you could create a lambda from that, for instance, that takes the parameters and then you would have like a little factory. That would be one thing. Or they could be just references to local variables and then you can change those.
Okay, so you could give it a ref to something. It's not
that should... Yeah, exactly.
Anything that is evaluable, whatever.
Yeah, so those numbers could be references to something. Yeah, so then you could change it. Or making it a little bit more generic. So that's perfectly generic, so because then you would have also the coefficients somewhere, but so I still have that one pole. And now my saturator, I have a function called saturated feedback that just does this kind of stuff described here. So you have a box, some arbitrary box, and you have feedback around it with a saturation function and some multiplication that's described by this function now. And now I can reuse it. I just can have this function that takes some box and puts feedback around it, and I would use it like that. So I have now my long chain of those four filters in series and some feedback around it. So I can now have a generic feedback function that I can reuse for any sort of feedback. And I compile it and run it, so. Yep.
And if you go back there. So right now you're sort of creating this one pole four times, but I guess you could, if you will, have a function that returns a single pole and have it called four times in a row, sort of to compose, like how would I do that? Is there any way of building on top of this to say, I would like four one poles in a row with your syntax, or is it more that would have to be done by something outside the structure? Like, if I wanted to say I had a delay that is a parameter, like here the one pole, like how many one poles to have could be an additional parameter to supply.
You mean you want to make this kind of chain more generic so that you can say I want to have two or four?
More
generic.
Dynamic.
Yeah, dynamic. You probably start using variadic templates, some form, and that's a good question. I would need to think.
You have a function you call to give you that type, and that type is then composed, and you just sort of, like, if you will, you do more
meta-template programming to compose this type, and like that has a counter that goes down and composes it and returns each value as
I mean, I think no, but I think you can just make a function that calls recursively itself and it always expands, so it just adds another one pole in its end and takes the index as input, then this should work. It would be kind of mixed compile time runtime kind of thing, but that should work.
As far as I understand, you're capturing the entire evaluation and the type of the thing plus whatever constants are built in. The structure of the evaluation is captured in the type, right?
Yes.
So if the number of poles is part of the structure of the evaluation, you can't make that dynamic unless you have a system like what Boost Expressive does, you know, where you have type erased boxes where you don't have visibility to the structure at compile time.
But fair enough that I might not be able to specify how many poles I want at runtime with like a variable that reads in, but it would be great to be able to say I want four of these. And it could be a literal four that composes it.
Well,
doing
sure.
that at runtime was
that's a different thing.
That's intriguing.
We can try it afterwards, maybe.
Well, I don't know.
That's interesting.
I don't know what the person was asking about, but somebody over here seemed to be talking about a dynamic selection of the number of poles.
Yeah.
Also. Okay. So the feedback right there is specified as a number one, sort of like is a single pole. You're always going back by one. Is it possible to specify? So if I wanted to build a filter that actually was more of a comb filter. But I'm like, okay, I either want to have one delay, four delay, eight delay, depending on my implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Is there a way to specify that delay being a sort of parameter to something that composes my delay? Or is it one of those, no, it's really part of that type?
So if your question is if the delay could be a parameter, essentially, because I want to...
It could be a template parameter.
It could always be a template parameter and then compose what I need.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Sorry. Yes?
I don't know if I'm asking the same question or not, but do you have one of these things which can kind of act as a switch? So based on the signal coming in, you can choose whether to go this direction, this direction, this direction, or this direction?
Basically an if-else or some kind of or switch case. A switch, I don't have anything like that right now. I mean, if you look at Boost, actually not Proto, but Phoenix, which is kind of the extension of Proto, they have like if else expressions in their framework, and I think pretty much the same, I could extend it in that. So I would need some extension to the language for that. I think I couldn't do it right now. But that also goes in the direction, if you think of DSP, this is a typical problem of like multi-channel DSP, where you have like, you have an input and then a second input, and like interleaving, they do different things. Like first one goes always through this structure, the second one always goes through that structure, and this is basically a similar problem. And they also would need kind of a switch, essentially. This would be a language extension which you would need to add. So it doesn't work right now, yeah. At least as far as I can see.
It would be a compile error if you don't match up all of the outputs to boxes to an input somewhere else.
Mm.
Or if you just drop wires on the floor.
Sorry, again. What was the question again?
So the question is it a compile error if you don't match up all of the outputs from a box to an input on some other box, you know, the final output?
The question is if it's a compile error if the outputs don't fit to the inputs?
Yeah, do they all get passed through to the end, to the output, and so you get...
Yeah, they get... Oh, I explained that in my previous slides. That was...
Well, you so
here.
In that one, you match them up, you know, you pass it through to another box, but what if they don't?
You mean in the end, the final expression that I get? Okay. I mean, the final expression will have as many. I mean, in that case, it will have one output. But if that would be the final expression, then it would just have two outputs.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it's not.
And the same also here. The function object that gets created would be a function object that expects two input arguments. Yeah.
So if you actually tried to compose something that was invalid, it would fail the compilation step?
If I use it wrong, it won't compile. So if I take this expression, create compiler to my function object, and then feed just one input argument, then it won't compile, get some compile error. Currently, I have some static assertion that captures that. So yeah, it would be a compile error. Or if it's too many inputs, then you also have a compile error. It just that has to fit, yeah. But you can handle that. Okay. So we were here. Okay, now a little back to the beginning examples. I had those two direct forms, which I explained. So how would you formulate those? That's pretty straightforward. So if you think about them, or if you look at them a little bit closer and split it up a little, you have those feed-forward kind of structure and this feedback structure. So that's just a feedback structure where the arrows go back, and that's feed-forward where the arrows go just into the future, and they go through a delay. So usually in DSP terms, it's called an FIR or IRR filter, or just forward and backward structures. So the forward structure, which is the left one, would be your coefficients B2, which goes directly through. Then this B1 goes through a delay. So you have a delay and then the multiplication. That would be that thing. And the second has a second, so it's two delays, one delay, second delay, and then a multiplication. And that's this, no, sorry, that was this one, and that's the first one. And then they all get added up, so plus, plus, plus. So you have those, oh no, actually those two pluses only, so that's this plus and this plus. And the same for the backward structure. That looks a little bit different. So it's this two, delay by one, delay by two, those two coefficients, so it goes through the delay, but then it has feedback through the input argument, and input argument now would be the second one, because the feedback connects them around, so I have to use underscore two here. So that would be the feedback, and now I have those two structures, and that's the second one and the first one, and now I can combine them. So my direct form one, that would be that form, is just forward sequence by backward part. So that would be this structure, and the other one is just swapping, and now you have the nice symmetry of just swapping the structure. Is now you have suddenly this structure, and that creates this will create this structure under the hood if you compile that and then use it. Is that kind of clear? I hope. So it's just translating those structures into the language. So here's another. That one is even more interesting. So I mentioned that in the beginning there are those direct form one and two, and then there are so-called transposed one. Here's just an example of a so-called direct form two transposed. The form is missing. So this one is a little bit tricky because now the delay is not in the input pass, but after the after the summation actually. So you first spread out, multiply everything, and then you sum it up. And while you're summing it, it goes through a delay, and also for the feedback. So this is a little bit tricky because what happens now is you have to write it down like this. So you multiply and you create three channels. So that's all those three channels using the comma. And then that's followed by a delay at two times. So this is just abbreviation so I can reuse it. So that's the first input argument delayed by one, added to the second. So this is kind of describing this kind of structure here. And that's, you have the structure twice. So here and here. And so I just sequence that twice and this way I describe essentially this left structure, so the feed forward part, but now with a delay and another point. And now for feed forward that still kind of works nicely, but for feedback it's actually pretty ugly or tricky, because now you also spread, but now if you look at the overall expression, actually the first one has no delay. There's no delay, and it's directly taking the input followed by a expression that would be that now, which takes input, and then the second one, which also has a delay in the input, and then the second one also has delay in the input, and adding them all up. And now if you put feedback around that, there is no direct input delay in the first argument. So the overall box, as seen from the outside, actually has no delay. The delay is somewhere inside the box. And now that gets a little bit tricky, because now I have to do some introspection, and under the hood, I actually have to take the expression, so the resulting expression, which would be this followed by that sequence, and have to transform it into another form where I kind of have control over the delay line, and have to create that in a certain way. But I explain that now when I explain a little bit more about the backend. So how much time do I have? 20 minutes about. Ah, sorry. So kind of little step. So just before I come actually to the backend part, I just want to mention some benchmarking. So of course I did benchmarks because it's pretty interesting. It should be of course fast, or as fast as handcrafted code. So this is just the example. So taking those examples and actually also those and the other missing form here, and having handcrafted version and version done with my library, and then benchmarking them. I was using Boost benchmark here, Google benchmark. Yeah, Boost benchmark is still missing. So you see that like the first direct form there is pretty much identical, and I mean this is, there's always some noise on the benchmarks numbers of course, but essentially you see that the overall performance is pretty much the same, and for that one form it even seems to be faster. But I mean it's really detail, you have to look at the assembly output as well, so it's kind of fluctuates, but the kind of order is always the same, so it's plus minus 5% or something like that. Same for that was for Clang, same for GCC, you see a similar result. So at least the first one is pretty pretty on par, and the other ones are kind of similar. And also if you look at the assembly output, that's kind of interesting. So this is just an example for direct form one, and left is the output from the library and the other one is handcrafted, and it's weird that it does a kind of different unrolling. So the actually the flows one seems to be better unrolled. So this is always like one computation, and it's pretty nicely structured. Four operations in a row. So all those additions and moving the memory around, and then it's doing a step of four, and the other one has just a unroll of two and some additional memory transfer. Some, but then code is a little bit more compact, but only processes two. So, but in the end, the performance is the same. So I don't know, it probably evens out the number of steps, plus the code is a little bit shorter. So much only for the benchmarking, and I mean, you could invest much more time on that. Yes?
Have you succeeded in discovering any designs that where the performance was not almost the same?
Yeah, I mean, I of course I had some. Sometimes it was factor two slower, and then I kind of. Sometimes it was a little bit random the change I did, so I wasn't 100% sure why it now suddenly is faster. But in the end, I could always tweak it in such a way that it. I mean, it does a lot of. If I show the backend in the moment, you see a lot of copy going on, and this kind of. I mean, I'm even very surprised that it actually gets that compact because of all the overhead which I actually have. So I didn't try the Microsoft compiler, I was scared of that. So first of all, I don't assume that it will compile out of the box, and then even if it would compile, I wouldn't expect such good performance. Yes?
I'm sorry, which benchmarking tool did you say?
Google benchmark.
I have another question.
Yes?
Do you have another team that's busy hand coding things and they're always trying to beat your code generated output?
We haven't got so far, but we have a team that does all the stuff hand coded. It's also motivation of doing that. Yes?
What's your experience of the actual usability of the excuse me of the DSL you've got there? Because mm-hmm. my impression, as you know, I'm not a DSP guy. But my impression is that for really simple things, it maps fairly well onto your mental model for what's happening. But as soon as you start generating more kind of sophisticated notions, mm-hmm. that you're really the DSL looks like it's maybe an assembly language for assembling DSP, but not a high level one. It's like one of the things I don't see in there, which I would expect to see if I was building a DSP component, is like I would expect to see a declaration up front of here's how many inputs I expect to have and here's how many outputs, and then you know maybe some names for the important things in the network, and
yeah,
that, you know, those kinds of things can be developed with Proto. It's a lot more work.
Yeah. Yeah.
So. Have you found like all your guys have no problem turning their diagrams into this? Or
I mean, okay, that was several questions in one. So I mean, So there was a high level versus low level usability and how our guys are using it. So I of course I showed it to some of our guys, and I think there are different opinions. Some are more old school and they really want to have the control and they want to debug into stuff. They don't like any kind of abstraction. So even we are using Boost Zimdi, for instance, a lot, and even that is already kind of sometimes a problem because you have it uses also Boost Proto under the hood, and then you have you kind of lose control over your intrinsics a little bit. But then there are some other people that kind of like the idea and they actually want that, and because they don't they do DSP and they don't like writing everything handcrafted, and they, for instance, one guy also is a big fan of Faust, and he really likes that approach, and I mean the usability has still to be proven. So I mean now it's kind of working, and we have to start building some more complex structures, and that leads to your next question: low level versus high level. So like high level objects, we have names. Actually, that the idea of that, at least so far, is to really build low level components, like really simple structures, and something high level where you actually have names, which you then see in the UI, for instance, or which you can reuse maybe. Or
I'm more thinking. Just the ability. So when I look at your diagrams, like some of the more complicated ones, I understand them graphically.
Yeah.
The mapping from that onto the EDSL that you've got built with Proto is totally non-obvious to me. I mean, that looks like it takes a bunch of transformation and analysis in between here and there.
Yeah.
You know, the goal of a good EDSL is to represent the person's domain abstraction for the problem, right? You want to declare the problem in the same way that you think about it, ideally.
Yes.
Obviously, that's really hard to do. Like, it's hard to map networks and graphs onto textual representations.
Yes.
In general. So I understand you've got a hard problem there.
Uh-huh.
But it seems like once you get to more complicated structures, you'd be better off, like, you know, labeling more things, using a more verbose kind of description that allows you to more naturally just sort of enumerate stuff rather than trying to figure out how to transform it into this very restrictive language.
Okay.
That's what it seems like.
Yeah.
So I'm asking, like, is that transformation, has that proven to be easy for people, or?
Yeah, I mean, it depends. I mean, you have to get used to this kind of language, but I mean, that's also true for instance, for the Faust language, which works similar, and people are using it. I mean, it's also kind of a little bit of a matter of taste, maybe. Some find it easier. They are so used to thinking in, I have my algorithm and I know how to write it down in kind of C, and then I write it and I have control, and here I always have to think. It also depends on the structure. So some structures, I mean, like the crossing already is a little bit tricky, and then it might get more complicated. Maybe you have a long feedback from here to somewhere over there. And then kind of we have to reformulate everything, then it might get really tricky. And
that's what I'm talking about.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You need kind of a wormhole connection or something like that, maybe.
You could invent your language so that it's, or at least a level of your language so that it's less mathematical, perhaps, but allows you to more straightforwardly state the shape of the network.
Yeah.
And then, you know, all the compilation could be just happen doing the same stuff behind the scenes.
I mean, yeah. This is just, I mean, as I mentioned really in the beginning, I think you weren't there, that this is kind of still an experimental phase. So it's really seeing how far we can get and how usable it actually is. And you definitely, even just looking at it abstract, taking C++ out of the way and everything, it's still problematic to describe all the structures. So you are, by the design of the language, you are limited to certain kind of structures and certain kind of problems. I mean, the colleague I was discussing with here, the idea, for instance, to express everything in some kind of matrix form. So you have something like a big long state and then a matrix, and the state can be, but the state is not something just floats, but it could be something like a delay line or kind of more generic structures, and the state, the matrix update kind of describes your update of your structures. That's another approach, which is also pretty interesting. To generalize that kind of matrix formalism, but then you still have the same problem. Some problems, for instance, in that matrix approach would be pretty easy to formulate, but pretty hard in that one, and vice versa. So I mean, maybe you end up having several domain-specific languages for really local domains. I mean, this is not easy to solve.
Yeah,
do that. And so your question.
But the graphical representation works for everybody, right? Am I
right? Yeah, sure. But also, I mean, you can always express any graph as a matrix. So that's also, so you have two formulas.
So what I'm trying to suggest, let me know if I'm derailing the talk and you want to take this out, by the way.
Okay.
Do you want to take it?
Yeah, maybe let's do that afterwards. Yeah, so we diverge a little. Okay, the question there.
Is it able to do things like upsampling? So, like, if you actually end up multiplying it by, say, the signal itself, right? Like, you basically need to upsample it twice.
Yeah.
Is there a mechanism that you can do that with this?
Not right now. So. I mentioned that already when there was a question about the switching, so upsampling. So the question is about upsampling. Upsampling is also kind of switching because you always have to, from one, I mean, right now it's you feed one sample in or one number or one thing in and you get one thing out. Upsampling would mean, I think upsampling you could make, you could always spit out two values and then have to put them in sequence, but downsampling is a little bit more tricky because downsampling is actually then you would feed two samples in, or maybe I didn't look into those and into depth so far, but maybe it's possible, but maybe you have to need some extension for it.
You might be pushing the interface out to the user where you're like, this requires two samples to produce one.
Yeah.
And then that means it's not one-to-one, and how do you express that? And you
have an
invention like, it has two inputs.
Yeah.
Sorry. You just need your output sample type to be a pair.
That's for going upwards, but if you want to go downwards where I need two input samples to produce one, that means that the user has to now know that.
Sample would be,
they can skip the
it's an order, so you would still return back only one sample. It's just you're going to do it twice. Instead of saying you've got one input, you're gonna
could be also an alternative. Depends on exactly the algorithm, maybe.
Or like when you compose the function, rather than just calling that function once, it's essentially you're going to call it twice.
Or you just don't return anything the first time. Or you return a thing, but it's not actually like represents the sample until the second.
Yeah. I mean, this multi. I mean, you could also have it as a type of the wire kind of thing that
the
it's.
The issue is you create your one pools there, right? You hard coded it, but ideally you're going to calculate those coefficients based upon your sampling rate. So now with the upsample, now you've got to let everything else know those one pools. They calculate the coefficients, the calculated on the higher sample rate as well.
Maybe let's discuss it afterwards a little bit. And so let me finish that. So we have like a few more minutes into the break. Since we said a few words about the backend. So actually, this is now the deep C++ stuff. So I don't want to go so much into detail, just a few important things. So it heavily uses expression templates, so I mean, I think that was kind of obvious so far already. So it's based on Boost Proto, so I'm using Boost Proto. I mean, this is a really great library to build stuff like that. It's really easy to have because it has all the operator overloading. Then you can configure that and define mappings for it. And as I mentioned already, it needs this compile step that generates the state for you. So how does that compile step look like? It kind of looks like that right now. This is a lambda just because I was too lazy to write the template there. It essentially has two important steps right now. Could be added more if they are needed. So one is, I call it formulating the expression into a kind of canonical form, where I always have, so I know, for instance, that there is no, if the expression would have a delay in its direct input, then it would have to treat it differently. So I'd always put kind of a front panel kind of on the expression, for instance, things like that, and or then I kind of reformat the expression so to handle the, if I have a feedback loop and there is delay in the feedback, I under the hood create a binary feedback actually where I handle that. So that kind of stuff happens here, and so I take the input expression and have a transformation onto another expression that but that still represents the same structure, and then I take that expression and build the actually state for that, and the state will be tuples of tuples of tuples of arrays. So I come to the state and next. And then I create actually the final little function object. So that's my stateful lambda. It's just the name I had there. And that takes all those stuff and takes the expression and then does the actual computation. So how does the state look like? So the state that gets generated here. So the state is, so basically it represents the tree of your expression. So I basically traverse the tree, and whenever I see those kind of indexing into the input argument, I will create, so right now it's an array, but it could be, I could replace it by some other type that is more suitable depending on whatever you need there. It creates an array, and then it creates for the subtrees, the state for the subtree. So there are always three arguments. The first one is basically for the operator I'm just looking at. So I start my tree at the sequence operator in that case. So that would be actually the second one because it's less left associative, that operator. So it starts from the right. But the operation itself is associative, so it doesn't matter. So I start here, I see there's a delay right on the right-hand side. So the basically in the sequence, there must be a delay. So I create that delay with two values that's happening inside that kind of wire. And then I traverse the tree, so there's a left and the right side. And both are empty in that case. So because there is the left side is also a tuple of one delay, which is basically the delay in that wire from that box to that box, this delay or that state. And then the two last boxes are empty. There's nothing happening there. There's no sequence. And the right side, there's also no sequence anymore. So empty tuples mean the whole thing stops. So that's how the state looks like internally. Yeah, the parentheses mean it's a tuple kind of thing. Just shorten that here. So this will be tuple always with three inputs. And the node, the state for the connection and the sub expressions. And here's just similar example. I put the parentheses a little bit different, and then you have this kind of structure. So you have the four nodes here, and you have the two delays, that one, those two, and that one here. So who's familiar with Proto? Actually, has anybody used it? Okay. But for those who didn't use it, just to explain really quickly, Hello Proto, I mean, that would be like your Hello World for Proto. So the point is about expression templates, you have to kind of infect, you have to get into the evaluation of the compiler when it evaluates all the operators. So you have to get into the operator and hinder the compiler of evaluating. So if you have something like 1 plus 2, there's no way to get in. But as soon as you have one object which is customized and has all the operators overloaded, you can get into the expression tree, and then from there on kind of capture the expression into a template structure. So that's what Boost Proto does for you. And then you can work with that expression tree and transform it. So Hello Proto Protolit would create a proto-fiable little object, 42, which is now not an integer, but it's an object that captures the 42. And if you have plus, and now you can write any kind of crazy stuff, and it will just capture that expression tree. So what Proto actually, you can display it, what Proto prints out is shift left plus terminal 42 and terminal 1, and another terminal. So that describes this expression. So I'm using Proto, so this would be Hello Proto. And then, as I mentioned earlier, my beginning example was rebuilding Boost Lambda in Proto. There's actually an example, but it was based on the, not on the transforms, but on the other context thing objects, which is not as flexible. So I had to rewrite it myself. So you have those in Proto, you have those transforms. So the placeholder is just a struct which has a template argument, and you can get the RET, so you have some number that represents the index, and then you have several transforms. This is for Proto, you need to compute the RET of some expression. So it takes an input, when the input is a terminal, it returns the terminal number plus 1. If it's any other terminal, it will be 0, and then if in any other case, it will fold over the expression tree. That's what it means. And here, then I did a little extension to Proto. In Proto, there are those callable types, and Proto is C++ 98, so there's no decal type and auto and all this kind of stuff. So that's why you have to, if you do your custom transformation, which takes some expression and returns something, you always have to define your result type. I mean, you know that from the C++ like binaries did plus and stuff like that, where you always have your functors, where you always have to declare result type of my operation is float, and proto requires you to do this really ugly overloading and then define something really complex. And I found a nice trick to make that generic and actually reuse. I have now my callable decal type, which is my own extension for proto. Yeah?
We gotta lock up the camera for lunch.
Okay, five more minutes. We started a little bit late.
That's fine. You know where the key is for the for the library.
Yeah.
Okay. And just lock it up and give it over to Marshall.
So I mean, this structure helps me to at least write a lot of custom transforms without going through the pain of doing this kind of stuff for all my custom transforms, which will be pretty ugly because I have sometimes really long functions. And then figuring out the type of the result type, especially if I want to have typed wires also in the future, it gets really messy. So this works really nicely. And then you would have some custom function or transforms, for instance, place the holder, which actually takes the placeholder and returns the value for it, would be as simple as this. So it's a function object that takes a placeholder and the tuple of the input arguments to your function or to your expression, and then just takes the value out of that tuple and returns it. And then the evaluation would be pretty simple because it doesn't do much. It just takes all the placeholders and replaces them with input arguments, with accompanying input arguments. In the other case, it's just a default evaluation for all the operators. So that's how you write proto transform. So you write those kind of really, I mean, it's really functional. So there's no state. So it's kind of this kind of a pattern matching in Haskell kind of thing. And you just write down your transformations in a really nice declarative way. So, and then, yeah, blah, blah, you can use it. Okay, I skipped that part, that's not so interesting. Just a few more examples and then I'm done. So this would be, this is just took a few pieces out of my library. So computing the input delays, that was a transform that looks like that. This is, I have the generator and the combiner. The generator kind of, that's how the state is generated. How the representation for the input, because I have to reuse it a little bit. I need that in several places. So basically what it does, it parses the expression tree, and for each node it figures out what's the maximum or minimum, that's what you can define in those things, what you want actually, number of delay for the expression and the resulting expression and so on. It goes down, it parses all the expression and defines a tuple, in that case, nested tuples that describe your delays in each point of your structure. So that looks like that. Then you can concatenate and two tuple drop and all this kind of stuff there and extend it really nicely. Okay, that's maybe, and last one. So this is just one example. So this is actually, this was basically the pre-processing so far, and now the actually processing, that would be my custom transform for the sequence operator. So that's actually when you actually call the resulting function object in the end, it goes through that function, so every time. So I mean, as you can see, it's pretty heavy and a lot of copying is going on, and but in the end the compiler gets it all out of the way. So it's really, that's why it's really amazing. So what it does, it takes the left and the right expression of the sequence, obviously, and then from the outside it gets a input. There's something happened there. It gets an input to the current expression and the state of the overall expression from there on. And what it does, I already showed you how the state looks like. It was this kind of structure. So you have those tuples where you have like the current state and then the sub-expressions. So what it does here, it picks out all those things. Then you have the input state, your node state, the state for the left subtree, and the state for the right subtree, which you then have to pass on. Compute some arities for the input and output of the boxes. Deep tie is a function which I also call, because this is one of the optimizations I have to do. If I copy everything, and then it kind of gets slow, but if I have create a tuple of tuples of references and things like that, so there's some kind of tuple magic going on there. And then it actually calls the evaluation transformation. So it kind of recurses into the subtree for the left side, and it passes on the current input for that tree and the delayed input for the states. And the output will be a flattened tuple. Then it does some concatenation, so you always have to tuple cat and tuple drop. This kind of does the stuff with the inputs and the wiring around the boxes. That's what the drop and cat does, for instance. So basically wiring the stuff around, so you have always you have to cut a few of the inputs because they go in the first box, and then the other leftovers go in the second box. That's why you have to cut your tuples into pieces and then rejoin them afterwards. And then it goes into the right expression, so now it evaluates the right expression, passes on the state and the input. And that's where the delay update happens. So tuple for each, I have some road page. There's also some stuff I wrote that kind of rotates into the array and pushes the new state, the new result, and works on the state. So it does some kind of rotate pushback. So it rotates everything in place, has a new argument that happens on the state and puts a new input in it. And then it returns the result. So it concatenates all the stuff it computed or it got from the sub expression together to one big tuple and returns the result. Okay, I mean, this is really kind of intense, but it works. So it's really nice. I think that's basically it. Some conclusions. And then I'm done. So some plus points of that is, I have now really nice declarative and composable embedded domain-specific language for DSP. So I mean, I can really represent those structures. It integrates well with existing C++ code. So if I know that some function, how some function works, for instance, the tanh function, I can just reuse it or have custom functions, whatever. I have something already existing, I can just integrate it because it's inside of C++. So the binding is really simple. Whereas if it would be a separate language, I would have to do some overhead there. So it benefits from all the C++ compiler performance things which we already have in place. I can immediately use a really powerful C++ type system. I mean, it's not as powerful as Haskell, but it's still quite powerful. And yeah, that's a kind of plus sides I have seen. And then downsides are that it's limited to the C++ syntax rules, so I have to do some kind of awkward tweaks here and there to press it into C++ world. Then of course long compile times. I mean, so far it's actually looking good. It was in the beginning I was using boost unit tests, and it was much slower to just include the header than compiling my little program. So I mean, this kind of gives you an impression of the compile times. And of course, if you do a mistake, you have huge pages of error. I mean, this is a typical downside of all this kind of template, expression template kind of stuff. So, I mean, you have to do a lot of work to capture all those potentially problems in which you could run. So, yeah, that's it. And thank you for listening.